So let's go ahead and get to building the first project in the Arduino Starter Kit. Now this first project actually is three different circuits, and we're going to build them one at a time, and we're going to modify the previous circuit to make the new circuit. You'll probably also notice that in this project, we are only using the Arduino as a power source. But that will change starting in the next video when we actually are using the digital input and output pins on the Arduino. It's because this is the first project. It's going over some of the basics of electronics and electricity and circuits and some of the basics of using breadboards. So because of that, we are just using the Arduino as power for this first project. So the first circuit, we are going to be controlling a green LED light with a push button. The first step is that we are going to be connecting the positive rail on the breadboard to the plus 5 volts port on the Arduino. Now we're going to use a red cable for this. The standard convention that's used is that a red cable is used on the power side, on the voltage side, and a black cable is used on the ground side. By plugging this red cable into the positive rail, when we provide power on the cable, we will actually provide a source of power on positive rail. Let me go ahead and highlight all those holes. So if we plug anything into any one of these holes, we are providing it with 5 volts power. The other side of the cable, we're going to go ahead and plug into the 5 volts port on the Arduino. Now, we're not actually providing power to the breadboard yet, since our Arduino USB cable is disconnected and we don't have anything plugged into the power port on the Arduino. But when we do attach this USB cable, or we do plug in the AC adapter for the Arduino, then it will be powered and providing power from the Arduino to the breadboard. For step two, we're going to hook up the ground to the negative rail on the breadboard using the color convention that black means ground. When I plug in the ground into one of these holes on the negative rail, that means if I plug anything into any of the other holes on that rail, it's going to be connected to the ground. And on the Arduino, we see that there are a couple of ground ports, so go ahead and plug in the other side of the black cable to a ground port. For the third step, we're going to take a push button that looks like this and place it into the breadboard. In the introduction to breadboards, I mentioned that that little gap or valley in the middle of a breadboard is there for putting integrated circuits across. These buttons are actually designed to go across that as well. So half of the pins for the push button will be on one side of that, and then the other half will be on the other side. We are essentially separating all of the pins to have its own separate row of holes that we can attach other parts of our circuit to. So for instance, if we wanted to attach a wire to the top left pin of this push button, all we need to do is insert that end of the wire into any of the holes in this row 15 on the left. The way that these push buttons work is that when they are in the off position, they break the circuit and do not allow electricity to flow across the two pins. And when you push down on the push button, it's in the on position, you are connecting both pins, and it will allow the electricity to flow, it'll allow current through it. These push buttons in the kit do not lock in the on position, so you have to physically press it down to keep it on. The next step, step four, is going to be adding the resistor to our circuit. One of the biggest things for you to look out for and make sure that you don't do is attaching the power or positive or 5 volts directly to ground with no load in the system. No load as in no resistors, no load as in motors, no load as in lights. The reason for this is that when you do that, you are shorting out your power source. And what that does is it allows way too much electricity to flow all at once, and your system usually can't handle it, so it gets overheated and you burn up your chips, you burn up wires, you damage components. And that's the purpose of this resistor in this circuit, is that we are wanting to make sure that we are providing enough of a load in the circuit that we're not going to damage any of the other components in that circuit, whether that's the push button or the LED light. And in reality, for this particular circuit, it's for the LED light. It's not enough of a load. And so by adding this resistor here, we're able to increase the load so that we're not pushing too much current through our switch or through our LED light and burning it up, right? We don't want to catch anything on fire. We don't want to hurt ourselves, hurt our equipment. Resistors come in different resistive levels. Some resistors have a high ohm number, meaning that it resists a lot. Some have a lower ohm number, meaning it resists less. Ohm is just a unit that we use for resistance, and the symbol looks like a horseshoe. For this circuit, we're going to be using a 220 ohm resistor. The way we know what resistor we have is by the color bands that you see on the resistor. The different colors stand for different numbers. In your projects book, in the starter kit, it actually has a color band chart to help you figure out what resistor is the 220 ohm resistor. It's on page 41 of the book. If you're using the 4-band resistor, which has that tan or brown background, you're going to look for a resistor that has a red band, followed by a red band, followed by a brown band, and then you'll have the gold band, which is your tolerance. And what that is that first red is a 2, the second red is a 2, the brown stands for 1, and so when you put that into the multiplier, 10 to the 1 power is 10, so 22 times 10 is 220. My kit actually had the 5-band resistor in it, and so you would be looking for a red band that stands for 2, followed by another red band that stands for 2, followed by a black band that stands for 0, and then a black band that stands for 0 as well, but that would be the multiplier, so 10 to the 0 would be 1, so 220 times 1 is 220, and then of course it has the tolerance band at the end of gold, just meaning plus or minus 5%. When you locate the correct resistor, I like to bend the ends a little bit. It does make it stick up a little bit, so you gotta make sure that that exposed lead isn't touching any of your other parts of your circuit you don't want it to. I'm gonna plug one side of it into the positive rail and the other side into one of the pins on the push button. In this case, the pin that is on the 15th row. Now with resistors, it doesn't matter which way the current flows through it, so you can connect either end to the positive rail and either end to the pin on the push button. In step 5, we're going to be placing the green LED into our circuit. LED stands for light emitting diode. A diode is something that only allows current to flow one way. And that's the reason why one of the legs is shorter than the other one. This is to help you know which leg needs to go on what side of your circuit. The shorter leg is the side that's going to be connected to our ground. I like to think of it as we're shorting it to ground. And so what we're going to do when we place this on the board is we're going to put the shorter leg into the negative rail or ground rail. And we're going to put the longer leg on the other pin of the push button. In this case, row 17. And when we do that, we have our basic layup complete for this circuit. So let's go ahead and trace the circuit path to make sure that we understand what's happening. When we plug in our Arduino to a power source, the red cable is going to energize the positive rail with 5 volts. Since one leg of our resistor is attached to this rail, The 5 volts is then going to flow through the resistor to the other side of the resistor. Since this side of the resistor is on the same row as one of the pins of the push button, it's going to flow to the push button on one side. Now, it's not actually going to be able to continue flowing if the push button is off, but if we push down on the button and connect the circuit, then it's going to flow through the push button to the bottom pin, the pin on row 17. Since the longer leg of our LED is also plugged into row 17, it's going to flow into that leg, go through the light emitting diode, and then the other leg is going to return that current to the negative rail and complete the circuit. All right, so let's go ahead and connect power to the Arduino. We don't need to use the power port to power the Arduino. The USB port will also provide power. So if we have one end of our USB connected to our computer, we can plug the other end into the Arduino, and that will provide power to the Arduino and also to those ports with the plus 5 volts or the 3.3 volts. We're also providing power to our circuit. So let's go ahead and test the circuit now that it's built and we've provided it power. I'm going to go ahead and just push on the button here, and when I do that, you'll see that the LED lights up. When I take my finger off of the button, the circuit breaks and the LED light turns off. And I can just turn it on and off and on and off as I push the button. So cool, it appears to be working. Let's go ahead and look at the next circuit we're going to build, where we just take this one that we've built now, modify it slightly to build that next circuit. However, before we do that, let's go ahead and disconnect the USB cable from the Arduino so that we are no longer powering the circuit. One of what we call in the industry best practices is to make sure that you have already disconnected the power before you start messing with your circuit. So go ahead and disconnect that USB cable and we'll be ready to move on to the next circuit.